Shalom. First and foremost, I'm going to start off by giving all praises to the Heavenly Father, Yahweh Bahasham, Yahweh Shai Bahasham, Rachahakwarash. Double honors to the apostles and the elders at Great Millstone who rule well. And as always, we give peace and salutations unto the elect. And this is going to be short. I've been meditating on the fact that this is the end, you know, and resting in prophecy, you know, more than ever before. You know, when you read Daniel, the seventh chapter, it gives you a list of the empires, you know, that would rule, okay? And that fourth beast, you know, which was the Roman Empire, you know, which fell for a period of time, you know, but was eventually reborn through the Renaissance period, you know, leading all the way up to what we know as the 13 colonies, Babylon the Great, and this beast system, you know, that currently has a grip over the entire planet Earth, you know, and, you know, once that little horn fulfilled, you know, its rulership, you know, the Heavenly Father would set up the kingdom. So I just wanted to go into that just to touch on it briefly. As yesterday I did a video on the joy of the hypocrite, you know, being but for a moment. And it all ties in prophetically. And that's just what I wanted to tie in as well. So maybe you, brothers and sisters, can have comfort as well, you know, when you read the book of Second Esdras, the fourth chapter. As a matter of fact, see if I can pull that up real quick. Yeah, you have to find rest and joy and comfort in the prophecies, man. Now this is Second Esdras, the fourth chapter. You know, when Ezra was, you know, having a hard time understanding, you know, why the Heavenly Father didn't just end, you know, everything at that point in time when he was on earth. You know, the angel comforted him. And how did he comfort him? Now, I start at verse 34. Because, you know, sometimes you get in that spirit where you like enough isn't happening, which there's a lot happening, but that's just your flesh. You know, that's just your flesh. When you get into those spirits jump on you. That's ultimately Satan, you know, because Satan wants us to doubt, you see, the reality of what's happening around us. And that's, you know, what a Christian does. You know, when you look at a Christian and their mindset, you know, they fight against reality. And that's the whole world, but I just use Christians as an example because they act as if they believe in the Holy Scriptures. But when you try to bring reality and tie history, you know, link what's happening now to what it said in the Scriptures, they don't want to hear that. But this is 2 Esdras, the fourth chapter, in the 34th verse, it says, "And he answered me, saying, Do not thou hasten above the Most Highest, for thy haste is in vain to be above him. For thou hast much exceeded, and that's what happens when you get in that spirit. Like, now we hasten the kingdom, okay? We cry for the kingdom, but we do also have to rest in prophecy and understand that there's particular things that must happen. The Heavenly Father ain't just gonna snap his finger, okay, and bring the kingdom. It's a process. Even when we get the kingdom, all right, it's still going to be a process. The Heavenly Father is not going to snap his fingers and bring the earth back to perfection. He's going to allow, you know, Yahweh Shai and the elect, you know, that remnant, that first dominion, to ultimately do what? Implement the laws, take down the heathen, you know, subdue them. That's going to even be a process of them understanding and learning our laws, all right? But everything is a process. The Heavenly Father works in a process, all right? Even us, you know, being born, having to go through our folly, and then, you know, at the point where we, you know, were awakened by the Heavenly Father, the Holy Spirit entered into us. You know, it was already preordained, but it was a process in how we received the truth. We didn't wake up, all right, when we were 12, 13, I'm going to be an Israelite. No, the Heavenly Father allowed us to go through particular things, experiences, and then what? He woke us up. So you can't haste above Yahweh Bashem Yahweh Shai. America has to do what it was set out to do, all right? You look at what Biden's doing, okay, and prophetically, all right, it makes you mad, but prophetically it makes perfect sense because this place would have to be Sodom and Egypt. So when you look at what's happening, you know, under Obama, you know, the alphabet agenda and all of these things that are happening, it makes sense, all right, because this man had a little season to do all of this. And boy, oh boy, has he done it. So verse 35 said, did not the souls also of the righteous ask questions of these things in their chambers, saying, how long shall I hope on this fashion? When cometh the fruit of the floor of our reward? All right, and even in this time, we have examples of men who've been laboring 30, you know, plus years, 20 plus years, 15 plus years, 10, or whatever, okay? And you have those thoughts, you know, at what point do we win? Because we're the only nation that, you know, the only thing we had was a taste of a kingdom, and that was for 40 years. You know, for 40 years we had peace, and then that was it, all right? You've had kingdoms and empires that have lasted hundreds of years, and, you know, so damn, you know, what, you know, Lord, when, you know, when are you going to give us our kingdom? All right. So as you read down, it says, on these things, Uriel, the archangel, gave them answer and said, even when the number of seeds is filled in you. All right. Meaning it will be a process, meaning you would have to come back. All right. On the earth and through the process of reincarnation, because he's speaking to Ezra. All right, in the men of the Lord, okay, the reward is going to be given at the end. You see, it said, when the number of seeds is filled in you, for he hath weighed the world in the balance. Now, when you read prophecy, the prophets would be set up in Babylon the Great, okay? So the prophets would not get that reward until Babylon fell. Let's get that. In the book of Revelation, the 18th chapter. All right, Revelation, the 18th chapter, Salakia. Revelation, the 18th chapter. And this is when Babylon is destroyed. We'll just hit to the point. Rejoice over her, thou heaven, and ye holy apostles and prophets. You see, this is Esau being the end of the world and Jacob being the beginning of it that follow it. This is the destruction of Esau, Edom's kingdom, which would be fulfilled in Babylon in this beast system. All right, which in latter days would have to turn on themselves. There's so much that has to happen before we get that kingdom, but we're here. That's the beauty of it. That's why you rest in prophecy. All right, rejoice over her, thou heaven, and ye holy apostles and prophets, for God hath avenged you on her. And a mighty angel took up a stone like a great millstone and cast it into the sea, which is the people, saying, thus with violence shall that great city Babylon be thrown down, and it shall be found no more at all. Okay, Revelation 11. In 18, and the nations were angry, and thy wrath is come in the time of the dead, that they should be judged, and that thou shouldest give reward unto thy servants the prophets. Okay? Give reward unto thy servants the prophets, and to the saints, and to them that fear thy name, small and great. All right? So you brothers and sisters who listen, okay? You weren't given the gift to go teach, all right, or go out on the highways and the byways, you brothers, you know, hey, if you're giving it all you got with what you got, okay, hey, there's a reward coming unto you, Because you got to remember, there's the 144, and then there's that large multitude, which the rest of the men, women, and children whom the Lord will have mercy on. There's particular people, you know, who may pass by the prophets when we're out preaching, and they may throw up a prayer for us, or they may say something positive. Hey, that can be, you know, hey, that could be they're sealing to get a reward. Who knows? Do something good for us, whatever. Help brothers out. That's why you should be doing whatever you can ultimately to help to build the tabernacle of David. And prayers as well help. You know, it's not always something physical, carnal, which you can help the, you know, the apostles and elders and brothers out if you could. But ultimately prayer, you know, having a, you know, putting up those prayers, you know, through the names of Yahweh, Bashem, Yahweh Shai for the men of the Lord, and, you know, to for the tabernacle to be complete. You know, that helps as well, man, above everything. It says, and to the saints and to them that fear thy name, small and great, and shouldest destroy them which destroy the earth. So our reward comes in this time. So in this chapter, in 2 Esdras, the 4th chapter, he's asking, when are we going to get that reward? In verse 36, the angel Uriel tells him what? Okay, even when the number of seeds is filled in you. See? That final seed where the prophets would have to come onto the earth, be rejected, have to go out to the highways and the byways, prophesy, you know, in sackcloth, you know, when our curse would be fulfilled, man. And this is the final generation we believe that we will have to go out and do these things. Now comes the reward. For you have weighed the world in the balance. So there's particular things that must happen. By measure he have measured the times, and by number he have numbered the times, and he doth not stir nor move them until the said measure be fulfilled. All right, so there's a process that would have to happen in end times, and you can read that in the book of Daniel, the 7th chapter. Let's just jump to that real quick, and we're not going to get too much of it, but clearly, Daniel, the 7th chapter, you could jump to verse 7. That's the Roman Empire, right? Now, when you jump to verse 8, it says, I considered the horns, and behold, there came up among them another little horn. And that other little horn is fulfilled in Babylon the Great, which is the revival of that Roman Empire and system, all right? Which pretty much came back into life at the time of the Renaissance period. But it really fulfilled being rebirthed into the earth through Babylon the Great, the NATO and the EU. You see, all of those lies and deceit had their time to rule on the earth. And that's what we're going to get in Revelation, the 20th chapter, which ties to the joy of the hypocrite being but for a moment. You see, so this little horn, as you read verse 9, after that little horn, see here. Before whom were the three of the first roots plucked up by the roots. So the French, the Spanish, the British, and America came out of the British. And behold, in his horn were the eyes like, in this horn were the eyes of a man, because he parades himself around as the Most High, but he's only a man. Okay? His science, all of these things he's boasting himself in, but you're still a man, meaning you were created. There's a program in you to do these things. But you believe you created the program, and a mouth speaking great things. And we see those great things being spoken into the earth at this very moment through science, through what Biden's doing, everything. They're speaking great things. And who's agreeing with it? Israelites, so-called blacks, Hispanics, and Native Americans are bowing to the image of Baal openly. All right. But the water, Yahweh, Bashem, Yahweh, Shai for the remnant. But directly after this rulership, what happens? And I beheld till the thrones were cast down, and the Ancient of Days did sit, whose garment was white as snow, and his hairs of his head like the pure wool. This is the Most High, the Ancient of Days. See? Yahawashah has a beginning. We have a beginning. Okay, but the Most High has no beginning. Now, how do you wrap your mind around that? You can't. Okay? When we come into that heavenly estate, there's going to be particular things that are opened up to us. But in this flesh, you can't fathom that. So the best thing to know is that he is. See, I am that I am is what he said. All right. He is Yahweh. Just leave it at that, because you'll bug yourself out. Hey, the scriptures say you don't even understand the process of how a bone, you know, the sperm, you know, gets inside of the egg, is nourished in rib cage forms. All of these things form, heartbeat. So you ain't gonna figure out the Most High. And the people who are, you know, the scientists and all of this, the explanations they give you are only based upon, you know, observation and partial. They're not the full breakdown. Hey, but the scriptures say when we get the kingdom, we're going to know even as we were made. All right. So it talks about after that fourth beast and that little horn ruled, which is Babylon the Great, that horn that the chip would come through. In Revelation, the 13th chapter, that's when judgment comes. You see, so this devil only had that little season, okay? His joy was before a moment. You see, from the Renaissance, all right, all the way up to Babylon the Great, to the end of it, that was his little season to work his wickedness and do the working and bidding of Satan. But through that, the beast is burned. See, verse 11, and I beheld then because of the voice of the great words which the horn spake. All right. I beheld even till the beast was slain and the body destroyed and given to the burning flame. So he's going to be burned because of the voice and the great words. That's why Yahawashi said, as a matter of fact, real quick, that's why Yahawashi himself said in the book of Luke, the 17th chapter. Just hit to the point. Luke 17 and 29. But the same day Lot went out of Sodom and rained fire and brimstone from heaven and destroyed them all. Even thus shall it be in the day when the Son of Man is revealed. So when Yahawashi comes back, he's going to come back to a place that is boasting itself in Sodom-like practices. So this is why Salakia. This is why it says in Daniel the go back to Daniel. And this is all through the Spirit, man. This is Daniel the 7th chapter. In 11, and I beheld unto the, because of the voice of the great words which the horn spake, Babylon, and I beheld even till the beast was slain and his body destroyed and given to the burning flame. That's Babylon the Great being destroyed, man. You see, and as you read down, you know, let's see here. This is verse 16. And I came near unto one of them that stood by and asked him the truth of all this, because he's seeing this vision. So he told me and made me know the interpretation of the thing. These great beasts, all right, which are four, are four kings which shall rise out of the earth, all right? And, you know, the Assyrian Babylonian Empire, you know, the Medo-Persian Empire, the Greeks, and then the Romans, you know, which are the four major empires that are going to rule on the earth. Now, as we're going to show you, that Roman Empire fell. All right. But then after that, this devil was given a little season, you know, after that 1,000-year period where it fell, he was given a little season to go out and work wickedness. And that's what we see. That's what we have seen. Okay. But the saints of the Most High shall take the kingdom and shall possess the kingdom forever and even forever and ever. Okay, so the fourth beast is the final empire, but there will be a little horn. Okay, verse, and I'm trying not to read too much, but let me read this. And I beheld, verse 21, and I beheld, and the same horn made war with the saints and prevailed against them. This gives an understanding as to why he was able to come over to this side of the earth and conquer our brothers, you know, and sisters, the so-called, you know, Native Americans. All right. this is why he was able to, you know, trade us, you know, in the transatlantic slave trade, you know, bring us over here as well, so we could all be over here in Babylon the Great, receive our judgment, all right? But then in the last days, the Heavenly Father would put the Spirit on a remnant, all right? So he prevailed against us until the Ancient of Days came and judgment was given to the saints of the Most High. And the time came that the saints possessed the kingdom. So that fourth beast is where the end comes through. You see that? Verse 25, and he spake great words against the Most High. And those great words that he's speaking against the Most High are fulfilled here when you get Revelation, the 20th chapter. Okay? This is Revelation, the 20th chapter. And I'll just rush through it. Start at 1. And I saw an angel come down from heaven having the key of the bottomless pit, which is Europe, all right, and a great chain in his hand, all right, and this is Yahawashi, and that chain means he can take down a nation, he can set up a nation, and that's in Daniel. He take it down, kingdoms, and he set them up. So here he puts a great chain on the Edomites, okay, which is when the Roman Empire fell, and for a period of 1,000 years, they were a no people. And he laid hold on the dragon, that old serpent, which the devil and Satan, and bound him 1,000 years. Now, we know in Thessalonians, we always bring out a particular man would come after the working of Satan with all power and signs and lying wonders. So is this speaking of the of a actual angel putting a chain on the spiritual demon Satan? No, it's speaking of a particular man who comes in the spirit of a serpent. Okay, because the serpent in the garden was one who practiced witchcraft when you go into the word. Hebrew word Nakash. Okay, and that's what this whole system is based upon. Witchcraft. The devil means the deceiver. Satan means the adversary. He's adverse to righteousness, and you can see that in what he's implementing in the earth. See? And for a period of 1,000 years, he was taken down and cast him into the bottomless pit and shut him up. So he was a caveman. He was not, you know, the end thing. All right? And during this time, our people ruled. They didn't rule in righteousness, but the earth was cleaner. But they were still bound to idols, but the idols were just dark images. Okay, but it was well known that the Messiah and the disciples, the pictures, you know, and the, you know, the relics and everything proved who the chosen people were. That was a known thing. All right, that the disciples were dark skinned. It was all sorts of pictures. Okay. So for a period of 1,000 years, he was shut up and the seal was put on him that he should deceive the nations no more. So the 1,000 years should be fulfilled. And after that, he must be loosed a little season. Now, the way this chapter reads, you jump to 7. Because the 1,000 years after that is speaking of a different 1,000 years. This one is where it continues. That's why the Holy Spirit has to guide you. And when the 1,000 years are expired, Satan shall be loosed out of his prison. Okay, and how long would he be loose? The scriptures say here, a little season. Let's look up this word, little. A little season. Satan must be loosed out of his prison. A little season. Loosed. Let's look up the word loosed. Because that's what this nigga is. He's a fugitive on a loose. All right, now it says Leo. Or luo, to loose a person, bandages of the feet of the shoes, okay, to release from bonds, to set free. And he's been able to go free in the earth and do wickedness. Okay, now without the understanding of the scriptures, you'll come to your own conclusion as to why this devil has done all he's done. But with the holy scriptures, you understand balance and you understand prophecy, and it helps you to rest in those things, man. Okay? So, he was loosed for a little season. Let's look up the word little. Little. Let's see. Micros or macros. Small. Little. This has not been a long time since the Renaissance period. Around from the 1400s, you know, until now. It's really not that long. But that was his time frame, okay, that he would go out and do what? Spread the agenda of Satan in the earth. And look at the earth under that. Small, little, length of space, brief, how little, number, amount, rank, influence. So for a little season, he would have rank and influence to do what? What would he do? Verse 7, and when 1,000 years were expired, Satan shall be loosed out of his prison and shall go out to deceive the nations which are in the four quarters of the earth. And that's what he's done via what? The sword. The scriptures, you know, tell you, even when you deal with Esau's blessing, in Genesis, the 27th chapter, his dominion, Genesis 27 and 40, and by thy sword shall thou live and shall serve thy brother. Now, this is his blessing. Genesis 27 and 39, and Isaac his father answered and said unto him, behold, thy dwelling shall be the fatness of the earth. So at some point, you would control the resources of the earth, the oil, everything. Now, it's a partial, he does have his grip on the earth, but within that, there's particular, you know, other kingdoms and things. We'll see our kingdom, and we're going to have full control. Esau's is a, you know, it's, though he does rule the earth, it's still partial. See, there's particular things he doesn't have access to, particular things he doesn't, you know, couldn't discover. He's still discovering things every day. See, we're going to see it all right, forever. It's going to be new forever. Yeah, how could you imagine that? I don't know. You just got to rest in it. To see something new every day, forever, for eternity. That's what keeping the laws will lead to. But he didn't keep the laws with his rulership. He offered up that wicked sacrifice that Cain offered to what happened. The earth is not going to bear its fruit and strength unto his ass. Because he's coming up some other way. In the dew of heaven from above, and by thy sword shall thou live. He went throughout the four quarters of the earth with that sword and with those lies, with white Jesus and everything else he came with, and uprooted everything. His science. Now that science was used to sterilize, exterminate, and then niggas are going to turn to that very science in 2021 for their salvation, man. You niggas ought to be ashamed of yourselves, man. That same science was used to label you a beast and kill off your ancestors, man. And you gonna do science, science. I hate to hear a nigga boasting in this man's science when that very science was used to destroy your ass, man. All right? And it shall come to pass when thou shalt have the dominion that thou shalt break his yoke from off thy neck. Now, that happened at the time of King David. Okay? Well, we ruled over the Edomites and all, you know, the heathen. We had them subdued, but eventually they got from under that and were able to wiggle away. But then after that, 1,000-year period. And that word dominion, ironically, gives you an insight of how he would rule. He'd be all over the goddamn place. Now, that word for dominion is rawad, to wander restlessly, to roam, to be restless. To show restlessness. And that's how this man rules. He's all throughout the four corners of the earth doing absolute wickedness, man. Okay? So, verse Revelation 20 and 8. And shall go out to deceive the nations which are in the four quarters of the earth, which is going to lead to Gog and Magog, Russia, and these various different nations gathering together to battle to destroy this damn devil, man. To whom is of the sand, whose number is of the sand of the sea. So World War III is being set up through this devil's operations throughout the four corners of the earth, which is based upon wickedness, and the nations are angry. Even the other Edomite nations are angry, but Babylon the Great is at the forefront of doing all or most of this wickedness. But they were only given a little season. That's why the scriptures say the joy of the hypocrite, okay? Job that little season. Job 20 and 4. Knowest thou not this of old, since man was placed upon the earth? You know, the Heavenly Father gave these heathen their rulerships, but they were only for before a moment. All right? That the triumphing of the wicked is short. See? The wicked, who were the Edomites, they were able to do all of this, but it's really just been a short time. Okay? America in itself has been here for what, close to 300 years? All right, before that, from the Renaissance unto here. So you're looking at what? Give or take. I don't know. Shit, somebody put it on the comment board. But it's not been that long, man. Looking at it in the flesh, you think about it, it's long, but really it's not that long. That the triumph of the wicked is short and the joy of the hypocrite, but for a moment. Let's look up this word moment. Ragai, a moment, all right, in a moment, the root word, ragai, in an instant, to stir up, to disturb, to make a twinkling, to wink, to get rest. So he would be in his bed, as the scriptures say, working wickedness for a moment. See, though his excellency mount up to the heavens, which, what is his excellency? Sin. That's why it says in Revelation, the 18th chapter, though his sins have reached to the heavens, man. His right hand is the right hand of falsehood. Though his excellency mount up to the heavens and his head reach unto the clouds, yet shall he perish like his own dung. See if they got a precept that will link to Esau, because I know one that will. Well, there you go. Isaiah 14 and 13. For thou hast said in thine heart. Now, who is this speaking of? The king of Babylon, which is known as the wicked in that chapter. All right. Also Lucifer in that chapter. So in that chapter, Isaiah 14, he's known as the king of Babylon. He's known as the wicked, and he's known as Lucifer. So you got to put it all together. But what did he say? For thou hast said in thine heart, I will ascend into heaven. And he's actually speaking about that. You got this dude, I forget his name, Elon Musk. He has this SpaceX thing, but what is it called? The Dragon. See, the Heavenly Father puts so much that you can find rest in if you tie prophecy to things, that you'll be good. But see, men fall out when they lose joy in what's taking place. And the only way to find joy is to rest in prophecy. You see, when you lose your joy, when you stop tying what's happening in the world to the prophecies, you lose your joy. You fizzle out and you start to blame others. Then you go like the dude Malak Shar. You get a pink, a lime green, tutti frutti haircut. It says, I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. I will also sit upon the congregation in the sides of the north, which are the Israelites. I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will be like the Most High. And is not he doing that via his technology? Oh, yep. It links us to Obadiah. Obadiah 1 and 3. The pride of thine heart have deceived thee, thou that dwelleth in the clefts of the rock. See, you're really a base man. But the Heavenly Father has given you leeway. He's given you power to fulfill prophecy and to work the hey, what does the scripture say? The wicked were created for the day of evil. The Lord have made all things for himself. Proverbs 16:4. Yea, even the wicked for the day of evil. So he needed Esau for the purpose of the movie. Whose habitation is high, who saith in his heart, who shall bring me down? Though thou exalt thyself as the eagle. All right. And though thou set thy nest among the stars, thence will I bring thee down, saith the Lord. Okay. And I believe in the 70s, the 60s, he started to, you know, put those satellites and all of those things up. And that was the same time that eventually the Heavenly Father put the Spirit on us, man. So though his excellency mount up to the heavens and his head reach into the clouds, okay, he's going to perish. So the joy of the hypocrite, the joy of the hypocrite, one that will take a video down for, you know, going into the scriptures, but leave videos up, all right, with people eating live mouses, what are they alive? You know, women doing all sorts of destructive acts, men doing, you know, you got men on YouTube teaching you how to cook crack, how to do all sorts of things. Those videos aren't taken down, showing you he's a hypocrite. Hypocrite is chanap. Hypocritical, godless, profane, hypocrite, irreligious. Now, everything we've read in prophecy as pertaining to how they would rule leads to this. So when you tie it all together, you come to the understanding that we're at the end. This devil is at the end of his little season, which is why we'll end it off here. It went a little longer than I expected. Revelation, the 12th chapter. Revelation, the 12th chapter. And let's see here. I'll start at 10, because that'll not have to explain too much. And I heard a loud voice saying in heaven, now has come salvation and the strength and the kingdom of our God, which when you tie that together, that's Babylon falling. That's Esau being the end of the world. Okay, so we're close. According to Daniel's vision, brothers, we are there. We're at the point where they are at the end of their reign. And it speaks. When you look at what's happening, when you look at these people, when you look at the condition of the earth, it's only true. It's the only thing that makes sense. No other philosophy, no other doctrine is speaking like this one. Okay? Now has come salvation and strength in the kingdom of our God and the power of his anointed one. For the accuser of our brethren is cast down. And he's being cast down now through this word, which accused them before our God day and night. And that word accuse is to categorize, categoreo. He's categorized us. He's categorized the Heavenly Father's creation, you know, and lied. He's led with deceit for a little season. You got to think, during that little season as well, that Renaissance period, the rebirth of the Edomite way, they were all sorts of scientists, you know, Edomite scientists came into fruition, which pushed these pseudoscience, which were all founded upon the fact that we were a no people. We were lesser than them. We were inferior. So through those sciences, which reign supreme into the earth today, this is why when you walk into a room, everybody's looking down on you, even your own people, because they believe the hype. That science has been spread throughout the four corners of the earth. No one looks at you as anything good because of Esau's science. And it's no longer racism, it's science. See, they can say these are the facts in science. Scientifically, you're a beast. Scientifically, you're just lesser than us. They study your brain size and they made all of these theories while they were high off of coke. And the theory became doctrine. See, here it is. These Edomites just created all of these theories. Theories. Now let's look up the definition of theory real quick. I have it right here on my computer. Theory. Everyday use of the word theory often means an untested hunch, a guess without supporting evidence. the evolution theory, which that's all founded upon Babylonian, Sumerian ideology, because the dude's not original, but he just put an Edomite twist on it. But they say their theories are well-explained, well-substantiated explanation of an aspect of the natural world. And see, they've put these theories into textbooks, into all sorts of things, and everybody's walking around proud and high off of these theories, but they've been lied to. So the accuser of our brethren, all of this stuff he's put out, he's being cast down now before it's being found out. We're actually superior. We're the Israelites. And you're the Edomites. And they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb, by the word of their testimony, and they loved not their lives unto the death. And that's the men of the Lord. And that's the only way to get from under the spell that this devil has. You have to come under this order. The blood of Yahawashi has to be upon you. In the spirit, which was from the foundation of the earth. The scriptures say the lamb slain from the foundation of the earth. All right. So that blood literally, you know, you had to be chosen to win. Okay. By the word of their testimony, which is why they're taking all of the videos down. This is how we overcome him. So you get why he'll take your video down, because really it's bothering him and it's a thorn in his side. That's how we overcome. Remember, he's a fugitive. You see, if a fugitive knew a witness had a testimony that would, you know, out what he really did, what do you think he go, if he could, he would kill that witness. If he could, he would slander that witness. And that's ultimately what he's getting ready to try to do. But see, we love our lives not unto the death, so the things he threatened us with, we have nothing to lose. See, Nick Cannon has something to lose. He's made a covenant with death. He's made a covenant with these devils. See, we don't have any covenants with you devils, man. Now, we do have jobs. You know, brothers, you know, we're in the belly of the beast. But ultimately, we look at this life as a passing through. This is not the end all be all for us. See, you listen to Sonnetta, you listen to Polite. Their message starts and ends in America for you Israelites. What they say, so-called black people. It's bigger than that. But see, we love not our lives unto death. So our message is different. It separates us from your everyday Black Panther, your everyday black movement, your everyday woke Jake. Because we are actually saying this place is going to fall and we're going to have our own kingdom under Yahawashi. So this testimony and the spirit that he's put on us is a terror unto this man's setup. Therefore rejoice ye heavens and ye that dwell in them. Woe to the inhabitants of the earth and of the sea. See? For the devil has come down on you having great wrath, because he knoweth he hath but a short time. Let's look up that word short and then we'll end it off. Oligos. Olegos. See if it'll play. Maybe it's turned down. Little, small, few, number, multitude, quantity, or size of time short. So he's at the end of his little season, man. So he's getting ready to lose his goddamn mind. See? Even when Yahawashi came on the scene, what did Herod try to do? He tried to, you know, make sure he slew all and as many Hebrew male children as he could so he can cut off that blessing. Well, they tried that in this time with drugs and lies and, you know, the thug culture and rap, everything that they've pushed on our people. But yet the Heavenly Father has made a way that that remnant could wiggle away, like Moses in Egypt. You know, when they were trying to slay the firstborn then. You know, the Lord put the spirit of where Moses was just put out into the waters. That's the elect, the remnant, man. And the Lord found a way for us to be nourished up to this point where he gave us the word, man, the Holy Spirit. Verse 12, and the dragon was wroth with the woman and went to make war with the remnant of her seed, which keep the commandments of God and have the testimony of Yahawashi HaMashiach. So there is a war against us. All right. Why? Because the joy of the hypocrite is for a moment and his little season is just about up, man. All right. And it ends with this doctrine. Shalom.